trophy case?
Should be 10, I think. Is it?
No, because he pinged it once with the star
mate. Thank you. All right, Linvala, Keeper of Silence, comes down on Mitchell's side. Now, that's not going to do a whole lot here.
Right.
It looks to me like Mitchell has hedged a little bit towards the mirror.
Uh-huh.
Linvala's pretty reasonable in the mirror, and Cunning Spark Mage is very good in the mirror.
Plus four targets.
Oathstone seems pretty good right here.
That's a card that you've probably played a lot. That gets a lot of commander play,
doesn't it? That gets a lot of commander play.
Yeah, lets you keep some stuff and then blow up everything else.
Go ahead.
Sachs is going to ping Karn one more time.
Doesn't look too thrilled at the situation. Karn is already at 12 and is just annihilating Mitchell's hand. Now, Gindy's got a little smirk. He says, I have turn 3 Karn and you don't.
Yeah, it's pretty easy to be pretty smug on turn 3 Karn.
It is. So Karn takes 3, goes to 9.
Take counter.
And Oblivion Stone puts a counter on Karn.
Plus 4. Huh. Is he ever actually going to stone for 7? I mean, is that a real necessity in this match?
What do you mean stone for 7?
Oh, I'm sorry. Never mind. It's Oathstone.
Okay.
I'm thinking Pernicious Deed for some reason.
Ah, gotcha. Okay. So he does go ahead and do that. He takes the counter off Karn because that's the one thing that he protected, and he has Karn sitting at 13 with Mitchell top decking.
Yep.
Flash in a Restoration Angel in response to Karn, and Gindy has drawn mono Tron lands and just goes turn 6 Ulamog.
And we're on to game 2.
And game 2 is upon us.
Well, you said that it could happen fast.
I did, and he didn't actually even need any of his help there. It's interesting because they run those, what are they, the chromatic star and the, I think it's chromatic sphere for the other one, where those basically sacrifice to filter and make a colored mana,
right.
And then they also draw you a card.
Right.
And that is very relevant for this set because it runs not that many colored spells. It needs to resolve only a couple colored spells throughout the course of a game.
Mm-hmm.
And it also cycles them through their deck to get them to more action.
Right.
So kind of it effectively makes the deck smaller.
Right. So like you were saying when we started talking about these decks, the Restoration Angel Kikiji combo can come out of nowhere.
Yeah.
So at the end of that game, we see Mitchell play the Restoration Angel.
Yes.
It's his last dash hope because he's living off the top.
Yeah.
So he's going to have to then draw Kikijiki next turn.
Yeah, I think he only had 4 lands in this case, but that is true. And like and in that case, if Gindy wasn't
Spark
careful,
Mage.
Yeah, it really if Gindy wasn't careful, and Mitchell had the fifth land, like yeah, you can just lose. Just oops, you know. Now Gindy's well aware, you know. So what Gindy's going to do is he's going to use Karn to exile a land, or he's going to use Karn to exile the Restoration Angel itself or something. You know, he can minus 3 Karn, exile target permanent, and he can make sure that doesn't happen. But yeah, I mean, absolutely. Like, Mitchell's deck can go from looking very down and out to looking very like I just won in one easy turn. Yeah.
So, looking at the sideboards, what do you see happening here?
Let me take a look here. Gindy has a Torpor Orb in the board. That'll come in.
Yeah.
I mean, that blanks Restoration Angel, Kitchen Finks, not as important. He'll bring that in for sure. I see 3 Combust.
Okay.
Those might... I don't know if he brings those in. I'm not really sure. I see a Bonfire of the Damned. That could also come in. Grudge. I don't know if Grudge is the way you want to go, killing his Birthing Pod. He'll still probably get an activation out of it before you get to Grudge it. He's got 2 Nature's Claims, another Worm Coil, which I don't think he needs. He has a Beast Within. They'll probably bring that in. He's already got one in the main. Now, as far as Mitchell goes...
I didn't come here to be interactive.
Avalanche Riders? Is that legal?
I just want to play.
Is that printed in some core set later or something?
Have everyone else?
I almost did that.
Yeah, it's time Time Spiral. Yeah,
Time Spiral. It's one of those ones they brought back. Okay.
That was show director and crack staff member Rashad Miller leaning over, giving us the Time Spiral tech on.
Well, Rashad is actually doing 4 things at once, and he still just goes, Time Spiral. Card number 246.
Always wanted to board in the second.
He said it's lower than that. 2 Fulminator Mage for Mitchell. I wouldn't be shocked to see those. You can keep your opponent off of a Tron piece.
Right.
And, you know, the key with playing against Tron is to keep them. If they get all three pieces, then the deck's amazing. If they get two pieces,
it's pretty unimpressive. Really much. So that the sideboard looks a little transformative in its ability to sort of be a land destruction deck.
It does. Because Avalanche Riders and two Fulminator Mage.
And then you start copying them with Kiki Jiki.
That's really good. And also using Birthing Pod to make sure that you get them. Yeah. No, you're totally right.
Making sure you got six.
Fulminator Mage is just double red apparently in his deck. I don't think he has any black. You know, one of the ways that you can get to Tron is by using a card like Fulminator Mage and then something like an Extirpate or Surgical Extraction to get all of one Tron piece away, and you put a huge crimp on their game plan. But that's a lot of jumping through hoops.
Right.
Sometimes they just already have Karn, and you're like, well, you won't be casting any more Karns this game, you know, as Karn goes to 100 or whatever. So
what do you think we're going to see out of Gindy here?
Torpor for sure.
Torpor.
Bonfire, I would probably bring in it. It is a board wipe against him. Combust can hit the Angel when he goes to try to combo off, but it's pretty narrow, I think.
Beast Within kind of the same.
Yeah, he's got one Beast Within in the main and one in the board. I would bring it in. Like, it hits Birthing Pod. But Karn does too,
right?
You know, the thing about bringing in Hate for Birthing Pod is that Mitchell can set it up so that he gets to use the Birthing Pod once beforehand, which sometimes doesn't matter. You know, sometimes just killing the pod now is a great thing to do. But a lot of times, you know, they'll get a key activation. All right, so we're going down to the action here, and I see an Oblivion Stone Tron pieces. I'm not sure which ones, and a Karn for Gindy.
It's the one that looked like the diving bell.
Yeah, that one is mine.
Yeah.
Power plant, mine. Power plant, mine. I'll say mine.
Mine. I think mine. I think I'm going to go with you. So turn one, Noble Hierarch from Mitchell Sachs gets him started early. There's a Chromatic Sphere there for Yindi, which he's going to play.
Hey, it is mine.
Yep.
We were right.
Good for us.
Yeah. Now, I do see a Pyroclasm in Gindy's hand. That Chromatic Sphere is a important piece when you have a Pyroclasm, because that is... He's got four Grove of the Burn Willows, but I don't think he can make red from his mana any other way.
Doesn't look like... Star and Sphere...
17?
Nope. And the Grove.
Yeah, just the Groves. So... If Mitchell, because I saw at least a Birds of Paradise in Mitchell's hand, if he has a 3-drop, he'll just play it here, like a pod or whatever. Plays Kitchen Finks on turn 2. It's some pressure.
Right.
It's not as impressive as Karn.
That's not as impressive as a turn 3 Karn.
Right.
But it's going to lean on Gindy here.
Yes. It's going to make him do something. So let's see what Gindy wants to do.
And of course, Kitchen Finks gains back the life from the Shockland.
Right. And he's going to play Ancient Stirrings. Look at the top 5 cards of your library. You may reveal a colorless card from among them and put it in your hand. Now, that can be, I mean, almost everything in his deck is colorless. Yeah, there's a few cards that aren't, but like his lands, all colorless. Of course, things like Chromatic Star that you see there, Karn is colorless. The Eldrazi are all colorless.
Sure.
So
we see Expedition Map there at the top of his hand.
Yep, double mine opener here, so that's not ideal.
It's less spicy than he wants, for sure.
Yeah. And we do see the map come into play. So this is a slow start for Gindy. This is definitely not the turn 3 Karn hand.
Right. Kitchen Finks is going to battle for 4 here.
Yep.
Yep.
Five.
Yeah. Hit you for 5.
But that Pyroclasm becomes quite something now.
It sure does. Now, Grove of the Burn Willows is on Mitchell's side, and he's going to play another
Kitchen Finks.
So that's actually going to still leave him with 4 power on the board, even after getting Clasmed, which is pretty reasonable.
Yeah. It's not... I mean, if Gindy doesn't Clasm, it's another 5 or 6.
Yeah.
It's 21.
I think Gindy's at 16 now because of the Grove of the Burn Willows, which is pretty relevant, but... All right.
Yep.
Oh, you can. Oh, okay. He just tapped it for colorless. Gotcha.
And we see the Karn on the peel there.
And there
is the Pyroclasm. So Gindy's just giving himself some time here.
Yeah. He's just buying time.
He's buying time so that he can use that Expedition Map.
Yep.
To get the last Tron piece,
well,
so that he can cast.
You mean the second Tron piece in this?
Well, he's got one. He's got another. I think he's got another one in his hand.
Oh, he does. Okay.
I think he's not tipping.
Nope.
Oh, nope. Sorry.
Triple Karn.
Triple
hand?
Karn.
I mean, I'd actually be pretty happy with that. I love Karn, but not if I was in Gindy C, because he needs some action here soon. All right. Attack, Birds of Paradise, go. See a Restoration Angel in Mitchell's hand. Doesn't really have a great target at the moment. That's Sylvan Scrying. So now we actually are, he's going to be able to now get a Tron piece, play it, crack the map, and get the third Tron piece for next turn. So, yeah. We are going to see Karn next turn, so Mitchell's going to have to get some heat coming down here.
And Mitchell certainly is not aware that there are three Karns in Gindy's hand. So
that's a great point.
He's going to attack into them.
Yes.
To try to keep them.
Avalanche Riders.
There's that Avalanche Riders.
Hit your. So Gindy's going to have to use his map in response here, but that's a big play. That was a huge rip. Wow. Because that's going to set Gindy back, like, at least another turn. And Gindy still has to find a way. I think he's got a second Expedition map in his hand, but...
That puts him another turn behind, yeah.
Yeah, a full turn. That's a big play.
Obviously, he's going to map up.
He's going to probably get another tower, I guess. But that's going in his hand.
Right.
That was a big play.
And now his life total at 11 being a little precarious. Again, like you talked about when we first started, Sachs' deck can just go into beatdown mode.
Oh, sure. And that's his plan right here for sure. Like, I wouldn't be surprised. So what's going to happen is next turn, he's going to Restoration Angel that Avalanche Riders.
Yep.
I mean, probably during his upkeep, right? Like, isn't that... Does that work?
Yes, because he could put the Echo trigger on the stack.
Uh-huh. It just has Echo, right? No kicker or anything
Correct.
Like that? Uh-huh.
It just has Echo. So put the Echo trigger on the stack.
Yeah.
Flash it out. Flash it back in.
And then say, you know what? I won't pay. We're good here.
All right, there's a Grove for Gindy. And he's going to play the O-Stone.
Upkeep with Echo trigger on the stack.
But he's not going to have enough mana to...
Blink this... Are we scooping?
Blink,
all right.
Blink
yeah.
this, go to game three.
Yeah,
well, he can't, especially, I mean, Restoration Angels is going to attack for lethal next turn.
Okay, because right now he's getting hit.
He's at 11, he's going to get hit for four.
For six? The Riders comes back.
Oh, that Avalanche Rider has haste.
Yeah.
He's hit for six. And then, yeah so he actually, yeah, he was over. I thought he had Xaxes there. But yeah, Avalanche Riders does have haste.
Wow, that Avalanche Riders was a very key play in that game. Like, we were going to see, so I was going to mention something about what you were saying about how he had triple Karn in his hand, which that can seem bad, right? Like, you're
right.
Like, oh, man, what are you going to do with one of the things that's really cool about Karn is that he comes in at six.
Right.
And so his minus ability is minus three exile target permanent. So you can go Karn minus him. If he doesn't get hit, like, let's say that Mitchell decides to attack Gindy, he can go... Minus, play another
Karn,
minus.
Yeah.
So you can take out three permanents in succession if they don't touch Karn in that intermediary time. And that's, like, I've done that a lot of times. I've played a lot of decks with Karn, and that's huge. Like, being able to just, like, take away three key permanents in a row, and you still have Karn.
Right.
It's a big deal. Wow, Avalanche Riders and Restoration Angel.
That can be.
Yeah, that's a thing.
And again... The Kiki Jiki just makes it crazy.
That's huge. Yeah, that's a big
deal. Yeah, I mean, that's Armageddon right there.
Right. I really like it, too, because since we are talking about a Birthing Pod and Court of Calling deck here, you know, he can get these. Like, it's not like, you know, he's just hoping to draw his one of Avalanche Riders. Like, he has many ways.
He can go fetch it, yeah.
Yeah, he can go get them.
Yeah, Kitchen Finks certainly could have turned into Avalanche Riders right there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, any Birthing Pod off the top would do the exact same thing, exactly.
So there's consistency and redundancy built in these decks that give them, and it's not just consistency in doing the one thing, it's consistency in doing the thing that you want to do in the situation.
Yep.
You know, there's situations where obviously he brings home the Avalanche Riders, there's situations where he goes and gets the Restoration Angel or whatever, or the Cunning Spark Mage, and he has that at his command the entire time.
Yeah. Deck's tough to play, the Niapod deck. Mm-hmm. It's a tough deck to play because you have so many options, and you need to decide when you just go for the kill or when you grind them out, like what we saw from Mitchell. Now, he didn't have a Birthing Pod, so his decisions were more straightforward.
Right.
But even then, man, I'm telling you, like, this deck has so many different avenues and lines that it can take to win the game. It's pretty tough, and playing against it is interesting, too, because you just do, at least for me, you know, since it's a relatively new deck, like, trying to figure out what the other guy's going to do, it's tough.
Well, I mean, I think you and I were both a little surprised at looking at the deck list and seeing the Avalanche Riders on it.
Yeah.
Like, oh, yeah, what a great idea.
Yeah, very good idea. All right, so Gindy's going to mulligan.
Mulligan.
I don't know how well that deck mulligans, actually.
It needs a lot of pieces.
It does. It has a lot of redundancy to find them, but it needs multiple pieces.
Right.
Yeah, I'd say it probably mulligans
pretty poorly.
Fairly poorly, yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Whereas Mitchell's deck probably mulligans a little better because he's got early mana acceleration to do things and then the pod and the cord to get the thing.
One of the things I love about this Birthing Pod deck, it has a feature of decks that I love. The oops, I won feature. You know, where, like, you mulligan to 4 or 5, and then you just go, like, okay, Birthing Pod, turn 2 off of a Birds of Paradise, and then, like, oh, there's a 3-drop, and you play that, and then you've got a Restoration Angel ready to go, and now you're 1 Kiki-Jiki away, you know, or whatever, you know, whichever piece you need, and then you just auto-win from that point.
Mitchell flashed his hand at us real briefly there. I see a Restoration Angel at the top.
That does not look like a key.
Yeah, that looks like 1 to 5.
He's shipping this one back, too.
Certainly, the mulligan is something that I'd rather see go away. Not the rule, but the fact that players have to mulligan.
Okay.
I'd rather see that go away. I'd rather see great players always play with a full hand of 7 cards.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
You know,
yeah, for
you
sure.
Can't, you probably can't get rid of the mulligan without enabling combo decks a million percent.
Right.
But nonetheless,
you could have a committee.
Yeah.
A committee of judges to say, that's not a keep. He's allowed to mulligan.
Right.
Yeah, it gets a little convoluted.
Right.
I think, you know, that being said, Gindy's deck can just go mine, power plant, tower, Karn. You know,
right.
It just gets you.
Well, and I mean, the one thing I do like about mulligans is it's a very significant skill tester.
Oh, for sure.
You know, great players know when to do them and when to take them and when not.
Yep.
You know, a lot of mid-range players will look at a hand and just ship it when they don't realize they could make something out of it, or they don't ship it when they should.
Yep.
That's probably happens more often, doesn't it?
For
that
sure.
They don't send it back.
That's like there's this curve. When you're starting to get good at Magic, the standard is to just keep everything. You know, like when you first start.
Right.
And then you hear some pros tell you that people don't mulligan enough, so then you start mulliganing too much.
Right.
And then eventually you become Louis Scott Vargas and you complete the circle and never mulligan again.
Right. So we saw Gindy play Sylvan Scrying to go get a mine. Mm-hmm. He's got 2 towers in play already.
Ooh, a Thalia.
That'll slow him down
a little bit.
Notch.
Yeah. And there is...
There's the mine he fetched.
So the mine is there.
And there's the expedition map.
And he's got to pay 2 for the map, which means he doesn't get to crack at this turn, which is a huge deal. Massive deal. Like, if he could have just paid 1 and then cracked that, he has Tron when he untaps, and if he's got Karn or anything big in his hand, he can start doing things, but he can't.
Right now, because now it's going to cost him 2 mana on his turn. Hmm? So even if he does fetch a Tron piece, he's only got 5 at his command instead of 7.
Right.
Wall Roots, also
I like that card.
In Time Spiral.
That card's sweet. I never got a chance to play with that until Modern, and I think it's great. All right, hit you for 3.
18. Yep.
So Mitchell has a ton of mana. I see a Kiki-Jiki in his hand as well.
Yep, there's KJ.
I see a, oh, do you recognize that one? Village Bellringer.
Yep, that's the untapper guy, right?
Yeah, the untapper guy. Also allows you to make infinite dudes because it untaps Kiki Jiki and then you make another one.
So he's practically online. Looks like there is a power plant in Gindy's hand.
Cards?
Oh, there is.
Is it? Is
yes,
that the top card?
That is exactly what that is. Man, nice draw, Gindy.
You know, you folks are seeing the overhead coverage of the map. You can't see me leaning over to the side to try to get a better look at Gindy's hand.
We'll talk about 2D and 3D later, Sean. Wow, that's sweet. Oh, he just has to pass back, though he doesn't have any action. That is rough.
Yeah.
I see a Forest in his hand and a Pyroclasm. He would love to cast that Pyroclasm, but he doesn't have access to red currently. I don't know what the other card in his hand is. Kiki Jiki Bellringer, an Avalanche Riders. He might just Avalanche Riders.
Yeah,
here.
There's. I think
just
there's
take
no
out his planter, his mine.
There's no downside because again, he's getting in. Then he gets in with the Avalanche Riders and the Thalia.
Now he can't cast Kiki Jiki here with his current mana base.
No, he only has access to two red.
Right. He's just going to attack. Now what? He could flash in the Bellringers on end step if he wanted, and then hope to draw a red source. He could just. I mean, obviously, Gindy doesn't have any action in his hand currently,
right.
You know, and Mitchell's aware of that. Gindy, however, does have ways to get action. He can draw Eye of Ugin. He can draw Ancient Stirrings, which he can play with that Forest in his hand. That can get him stuff.
Bellringers.
Untap them. Make a mana. Cast a 3-drop? Did he play the... No, he would have done that pre-combat if it was a Pride Mage. I don't know what he did.
Yeah, he's set that off screen. Maybe we can get a report from Crack Staff over in the feature match pit. There was life gain involved.
So it must be a Finx. It was 3 mana.
Yeah. Oh, there we go. So Kitchen Finx.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, I guess he feels comfortable that Gindy doesn't have any action and just doesn't mind... It's letting him sit on his Tron pieces for now. I mean, Kitchen Finks attacks. I think I just would have Avalanche Riders.
Yeah, I was just going to ask you.
Now,
right.
Attacks for 2 next turn. That's 4. He's only going to get in for 3 if the Finks. The life gain is irrelevant. Maybe I'm missing a piece that he's going for here. But I like taking Gindy off and just saying,
right.
You know, if Gindy draws a Karn or something, like just.
Well, I mean, he can know. If. Right. If he can, the number of cards in Gindy's hand might be significant too, in Mitchell's thought process here. But it seems like taking him off the Tron mana and just beating him down.
Yeah.
He knows he's got the Restoration Angel. He's ready to go. I'm not sure. All right. So
it's just a little gambly here. I mean, for the most part, Gindy doesn't have great ways to find action. So you know, it's a pretty safe bet. But I. Like, I just like getting in the extra damage, to be honest. He's got Kiki Jiki in his hand. He has a Pride Mage, and he has the Riders. That's Mitchell's hand.
I mean, I tempo is on his side. I mean, even if Gindy resolves a Karn right here.
He drew another power plant.
There's still a fair amount of damage coming.
Pyroclasm of you.
His way.
Yeah.
That's pretty significant.
That's a very nice rip.
Although the Avalanche Riders wouldn't have impacted that play.
Nope. I mean, Mitchell's Finks are a little bit more resilient there, for sure.
Here comes Kiki Jiki, though.
Yeah, Kiki Jiki. What is it going to copy? Oh, combo out, right. Extend the hand. So So Kiki Jiki copies Bellringer, untaps everything, copies Bellringer, untaps everything, and...
makes a zillion guys,
so
which are all hasty.
He did end up hitting that red mana that he needed, and that was it.
That's it. 2-1 for Mitchell Sachs over Charles Gindy.